Okay, well, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to this latest session in the course on technology and the future of medicine. Today, Jack Tuszynski is going to take us through quantum biology. So take it away, Jack.
Thank you very much, Kim. Hello, everybody. Good afternoon. First of all, before I start this saga, how many of you took physics at any level, university level? Okay. Quantum physics? One. Okay. So we'll go easy. Because the topic is quantum biology, so we're fusing two completely different fields. It's happening before our eyes, actually. But most people are not aware of it. And this is exactly a parallel between now and about a century ago. It was exactly the same situation. In fact, at the turn of 19th and 20th century, many famous physicists felt that there was nothing to be discovered. And there was a very famous address by Lord Kelvin at the Royal Society who said that physics is done, the rest is engineering. And then a mere two decades later, there was an explosion of creativity unparalleled in the history of human civilization. I'm not speaking as a physical imperialist, but I think there's nothing really that compares to quantum physics in any of human endeavors. And all the technology that we have today, all that we enjoy, is largely because of this revolution that took place about a century ago, directly or indirectly. And this is a historical moment, a Solvay conference in Brussels, 1927, that gathered all the personalities, the figures, the geniuses. Almost everybody in this photograph got a Nobel Prize, and most of them got Nobel Prizes for various aspects of quantum physics. In the center, you have Albert Einstein, and then you have people like Marie Curie on the left, and Max Planck next to her for the left, and Paul Dirac, and Schrödinger, and Heisenberg, Werner Heisenberg, and on and on. What actually made it possible was the explosive growth of mathematics in the 19th century, and that enabled physicists to grasp reality with very sophisticated tools. I think what we are seeing today in biology probably doesn't require so much math, although I still think that there may be some unexpected twists, but the incredible advances made in technology, in measurement techniques in biology, where now seeing single proteins being imaged inside cells in real time, and obviously there are limitations because we can't see them all, but we can label some of them, and then this leads to probing biological matter to unparalleled precision, both in time and space resolutions, as well as in terms of the forces and energies that we can measure. So before I go into biology, I think I'll give you a bit of a primer on quantum physics, as some of you never took physics, most of you never took quantum physics. So I think it's in order that we just cover the bases. So what are the basics of quantum mechanics? And actually, there'll be more than basics. I will also point out some lesser-known facts, and some facts which I believe are escaping even those people who talk about quantum biology. So first of all, as you probably know, that physics took about three centuries to reach that point, and it started with Sir Isaac Newton. Classical mechanics was born again, because Newton single-handedly discovered the calculus. So mathematics and physics go hand in hand. That was exactly paralleled three centuries later with quantum mechanics, but maybe not so much by a single person. So we all think that classical mechanics, the concepts of Newtonian mechanics, and also electromagnetism developed by Maxwell, Ampere, and others, pertain to macroscopic phenomena, systems that we are intuitively connected to and understand intuitively. I think nobody really understands intuitively microscopic phenomena in quantum physics. Even the creators of quantum mechanics admitted not to understand what they discovered. In fact, some of them resisted it, including Einstein, famously said that he didn't believe God played dice until his deathbed. I mean, he never bought into it, but that's another story. So microscopic, classical, microscopic, quantum, where is the division line? We really don't know. And I think this division line is a moving target. In fact, as I listed here in yellow, there are microscopic phenomena that are quantum, demonstrate to be quantum. And again, most of these discoveries that are listed here earned the discoverers the Nobel Prizes. So there are microscopic phenomena such as superfluidity, superconductivity, laser action, and also crystal dynamics, which cannot be properly explained without quantum mechanics. So if somebody says, biology is big and so on, and quantum mechanics only pertains to individual particles at the level of, let's say, angstroms, this is not true. And another criticism that sometimes is leveled at people who promote quantum mechanics at all levels, at all scales, is that biology exists at, let's say, physiological temperatures, room temperature. And therefore, it really eliminates any quantum to be coherent at this level of temperature excitation. And that is also not quite true. Some of these phenomena that I listed in yellow again persist at the quantum level to room temperature. Superconductivity is not there yet, but it's not far. Definitely, laser action is a quantum phenomenon, and it exists at room temperature. It's enough to use a scanner or a laser pointer. You know that this is happening at 20 Celsius, not at zero Kelvin. So obviously, this is a slightly different kettle of fish because lasers require constant stimulation. So it's a non-equilibrium phenomenon. Nonetheless, for every criticism, there will be a counter-argument. So let's go back to the foundations of quantum mechanics. And what is the major fundamental difference between quantum and classical description of physical reality? Because I think there's a deep philosophical difference that a lot of people think about and realize how fundamental this is. First of all, in classical physics mechanics, we have objects with masses which have defined positions and velocities. So every object will have a mass, maybe some spatial distribution, where it is located, where it's going. In quantum mechanics, you have to dispense with this naive description of reality because every system is described in terms of a mathematical abstraction called the wave function. So, and the wave function is actually itself is not measurable. We'll come to it in a second. Only manifestations of these wave functions can be grasped by measurement, even then with uncertainties. So we move away from certainty, from determinism that we are so comfortable with in classical physics to uncertainty and probability. So quantum mechanics, in the end, provides you with probabilities of things happening, not with certainty. It never happens. And that also leads to the question of observer and the observed object. In classical physics, we ignore the observer. We don't really bother about introducing the effect of the observer on the system because the system typically is so large that our influence can be minimal, if not negligible altogether. In quantum mechanics, you can never do that. You can never escape the fact that every measurement, even the most delicate and precise measurement will disturb the system that you measure. So at the level of a particle, elementary particle, let's say electron or proton, you have to measure this object, this physical system, with something that is comparable to it. Another electron, or another particle, or a photon, a quantum of electromagnetic radiation. So it's obvious that you will have an effect, no matter what you do. And finally, the word quantum has connotations, and actually it is somewhat misleading. It goes back to the origins of quantum physics. Quantization of energy levels of atoms and molecules, which was one of the major discoveries. In other words, again, classically we're used to thinking that we have a range of energies available to every system. You can accelerate your car from 0 to 100 with all the intermediate velocities and associated energies. In quantum mechanics, it's not like that, by and large, with exceptions again. Typically, electrons and other elementary particles will have defined energy levels at discrete values. So you cannot have 1.5 quantum of energy. You can only have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 integer numbers. So that's why it's called quantization or quantum mechanics. And the most bizarre, unfortunately you can't read this red, I'm sorry. Probably the most bizarre aspect of quantum mechanics is the limitation on our knowledge. And this is a philosophical concept which actually is mathematically provable. And that is really hard-hitting, because you can't get away from perverse nature of Heisenberg uncertainty principle, which tells you that for any quantum system you can think of, you can never, ever know it completely. You can never simultaneously determine the position and momentum, velocity. You can never simultaneously determine all three spin components of its spin value. You can never simultaneously determine the angle and angular momentum of a spinning system. Or you can never determine both the energy and the time. So if you say that I measure the energy of this system at that time, well, yes, but never exactly. You cannot do this exactly. You will err either on the side of time measurement or the energy or both. But you cannot be precise in both, stating the both values of these quantities. So this is bizarre, and it takes time to sink in. It is fundamentally different. I will skip the philosophy aspect. I hope you will think about it, because it's profound. It really is profound. And again, one aspect that I will not talk about, but you can think about, is how this relates to cognitive processes. Our brain, the functioning of the brain, consciousness, and so on, because many people think that our brain can only be properly explained in terms of how it functions using quantum mechanics. Otherwise, it doesn't make sense. And Sir Roger Penrose wrote books about it. Maybe you've seen some of them. The Shadows of the Mind was the famous one that started this whole dialogue. Let's go back to history. Again, turn of the century. And I'm saying this to draw a parallel between physics at the turn of 19th century and biology at the dawn of 21st century. There were several experiments that shattered the world of theoretical physics and physics in general about 100 years ago. And one of these experiments was very precise measurements of blackbody radiation. That is radiation, electromagnetic radiation emitted by all objects at various temperatures. Every object emits, because it vibrates, emits radiation. And at that time, a branch of physics was already in existence called statistical physics that allowed you to very precisely calculate properties such as the spectrum of radiation. And many people tried, and nobody could explain these observations. It took a genius, actually Max Planck, who was at that time the most famous physicist alive. He was an expert in thermodynamics and statistical mechanics, and he basically banged his head against the wall until he came up with something completely counterintuitive, that to explain the observations of radiation coming from the sun or from other objects nearby, you needed to assume something that simply didn't exist in physics until then, namely that energy exists in integer packets, quanta. So you can only have one, as I said, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 units of energy emitted by this object, but not fractional values or continuous values. And so he worked this out, put a formula together, and of course got the Nobel Prize. What else? 1918. And again, he struggled mentally. He thought it was very artificial. By the way, he also introduced, this formula also introduced a fundamental constant. In physics, there are several fundamental constants that simply are part and parcel of our universe, matter as we know it. You cannot derive them from any more fundamental principles. They simply are. And the Planck constant, as it's called, which is written down there, 6.6 10 to the minus 34th joules times seconds, is one of those constants. We simply don't know where it came from, God-given. And it's fine-tuned. Well, time permits, we'll come back to it, because I, at the end of this talk, I want to propose a biological Planck constant. I'll call this one physical Planck constant. And so this Planck constant links two completely different physical concepts that were decoupled until then, namely frequency and energy. And again, this wave-particle duality. So I mentioned to you that one of the striking features of quantum physics is that matter is really a wave function. So it sometimes behaves like a wave, sometimes behaves like a particle, but you cannot really say that this is one or the other. So frequency is typically assigned to waves. So, and you can go from the wave property, frequency, to a matter property, energy. And Planck did it. Just because he wanted to explain the this interesting phenomenon. The second interesting and very useful phenomenon that you can actually play with if you go to the washroom, photocell. I'm not insinuating anything untowards. No. We now have photocells. If you put your hands in front of the tap, water will start flowing, right? So this is because of that phenomenon, the photoelectric effect. So what is it? The photoelectric effect basically links electromagnetic waves, light, to conductive properties, electrons flowing between two electrodes, as illustrated in this diagram. The current that results from shining light on one of the electrodes will be measured, and that has been done. And the explanation to this was given by Einstein, and this is the paper, one of the five papers that Einstein wrote in 1905, the five papers that changed the history of the universe, is one of those, and that is the one that gave him the Nobel Prize, not the other ones, like special relativity and stuff. Small things. So what's the explanation? The explanation is that electrons are held to the surface of the metal by finite binding energy. And if you can overcome this energy by giving the impetus from light to those electrons floating on the surface of the metal, they will be ejected, and then electric field will drive them to the opposite electrode, and the current can be measured. So that's the explanation. And again, in the process of explaining this, the mathematical formula that Einstein used, again, is Planck's quantization principle. Energy equals Planck's constant times frequency. So that was an independent confirmation that Planck's assumption had a universal value. There were some other experiments that all put together a very tight conceptual framework, And I've just listed them here because there's no point in going through all of this. You can take a first year, or maybe not first year, second year quantum mechanics course, and you'll get introduction to it. So the Compton effect shows basically that light can disturb particles. Photons can hit electrons, and the electrons will change the course of their trajectory. So that shows you that, again, the duality of matter, that light is not just innocuous. It can have a profound effect on matter particles. And then the second on the list actually is also very fundamental, the atomic absorption emission spectra. So various types of atoms were subjected to either emission processes or absorption, and it turned out that there are very sharp lines. Only very specific frequencies of radiation are absorbed or emitted, and that led to the construction of the Bohr model of the atom, where you have the nucleus and the electrons in orbits, but the orbits are very well defined, and the electrons can not only jump from orbit to orbit, but not in between. And then double slit experiment, where both electrons and photons go through a double slit. That's an ancient experiment, one of the oldest experiments done in physics, going back to Young in early 19th century, but now done on individual particles, not light, but particles. And particles ended up showing the same patterns as light. In other words, demonstrating that particles are also wave-like because they interfere. And it's like going through this door or that door. And if we leave this class in about an hour or so, you'll make a choice. You go this way or that way. If you were an electron, you would go through both. That's the mystery. And finally, this Stern-Gerlach experiment, which is a very important experiment because it illustrated the existence of another variable, which is specifically quantum spin. Quantum particles like electrons and protons and neutrons all have spin. And it's not just a fanciful thing, because without spin, there is no magnetism. And magnetism, as you know, was even familiar to the ancients in Greece and India and so on. People knew about magnetism. And magnetism, by the way, I forgot to mention, it's a very good example. Magnetism is a macroscopic phenomenon, which is quantum. You all played with magnets probably when you were in elementary school. At the bottom of this concept is the existence of spin. All right, I have to speed up a little bit. Quantum mechanics was built not only through experiments, but also theoretical developments. Several postulates were required for this. It's a very elegant theory, very mathematical, very tight, and internally consistent, but utterly impossible to understand. So the first postulate is that the description, mathematical description of physical objects requires the wave function. That's the postulate. You have to take it or leave it. When I used to teach quantum mechanics in my undergraduate, to my undergraduate physics students, I always told them, don't overthink it, just do it. You know. So you solve 500 problems in quantum mechanics, and then you'll understand what's going on. The second postulate is basically relates the wave function to probabilities. The square of the wave function is interpreted as the probability that a particle was or is at a certain point in space and time. The third postulate is the most bizarre. This is putting all of physics on its head. You have to abandon common sense, basically, to buy into it. It says that from now on, we don't have a position of a part. We don't have a momentum. We don't have energy. We have mathematical objects called Hermitian operators. They have specific properties. I have no time to go into form an algebra. And these operators act on wave functions. the question of what is the value of position and energy of a particle is turned into a mathematical formula. What is the eigenvalue of this observable? Observable is a Hermitian operator that represents the physical properties I just said. So what is the eigenvalue? And that's solving a particular equation. Energy is, I spelled out the momentum, is a first order partial derivative with respect to position. That's how you define momentum in quantum physics. In classical physics, you may remember it's mass times velocity, right? Easy. Now, this is not so easy. But trust me, and you have to trust me, it makes sense. Okay. And the fourth postulate was born over a two-week period of intense thinking on the part of Erwin Schrödinger, who will reappear in a few minutes in a different context. He spent winter vacation in Gstaad in Switzerland, and he spent his days trying to replace Newton's equations of motion with something better. And he came up with this, what we now call the Schrödinger equation. You may have heard the name, the Schrödinger equation. This is the end-all and be-all in quantum mechanics. That's like Newton's equations. Looks a bit more complicated, because it is. But anyway, if you can solve it, that's the best we can come up with. And the solutions of Schrödinger's equations are basically wave functions. The shape of the wave function, the evolution of the wave function, the state of the system at time point zero and any point in the future, evolution of the system. You can predict it. But again, probabilities. It's not deterministic in the sense of, I will tell you where this particle is 5 minutes from now. I will tell you what is the probability distribution of this particle 5 minutes from now. Or in other words, I think probably the easiest way of using some intuitive metaphor is public opinion polls. Because you have the nation, let's say, all Canadians are like a wave, big wave function. And there is not a single opinion about anything, but there is a probability distribution, right? So, you know, 50% will vote PC and the rest NDP, whatever. Today, what will happen a year from now, we can make predictions, but it's only a probability distribution. Somebody will tell you that the probability will drift towards NDP. And so on, under various conditions. So this is roughly what quantum mechanics is doing. Okay, so now let's switch gears and try to see how this can possibly have any relevance to biology. So first of all, physicists think that everything reduces to physics. And I'm no different, to be quite honest. But I will tell you that there are some very subtle aspects that one has to keep in mind. So we can, you know, look deeper and deeper, start from the molecule, even biomolecule, and break it down into atoms, and atoms into nuclei, and electrons, and nuclei into neutrons, and protons and neutrons into quarks. So it's like, the Russian babushkas, right? Little figures, you open up and there's another one, onions, and you peel the outer layers and you see more and more. You can think about this like that, hierarchies. So why not living matter? Because all of this here definitely is subject to quantum mechanics. There are some problems. We could think about an organism being composed of organs and tissues and those of cells and proteins from DNA, it's coded by DNA, and DNA has nucleotides, and those definitely have atoms. So somewhere at the bottom, we have quantum mechanics, but the question is it relevant? So we have these two guys that kind of shaped our universe as we know it today. Erwin Schrödinger on the left and Darwin on the right. The world of biology and the world of physics. And nature, by the way, is a great experimentalist. And I think any one of you who knows the theory of evolution understands that evolution is really a very long experiment, about 2 billion years long in time, and explores a huge conformational space of genes and trying to see what will be the optimal solution for a given set of conditions. So now think about this for a second. It took us, 300 years, 400 years, maybe 500 years as humans to come up with something as sophisticated as quantum mechanics and its applications, cell phones and lasers and stuff. Nature had 2 billion years of exploration at its disposal. I mean, I can't believe that nature didn't stumble upon quantum physics. It's just impossible. And I'll give you examples that actually support this statement. So even just thinking about this in terms of a huge laboratory, which is the Earth, and the huge amount of time and parallel experiments going on, I'm sure many of these applications, because quantum effects are very subtle and very sensitive, could have found useful manifestations in biology. So where difficulties arise in a simplistic, top-down approach or reductionist approach, as we all sort of subscribe to in Western science, is the existence of hierarchies, conceptual hierarchies. And when you think about different fields of endeavor, even within physics, you have elementary particle physics forming a manifold with all the elementary particles and their interactions, weak forces, strong forces, that you never hear about in other fields of physics even. And then you have condensed matter physics, things like crystals and magnets and so on. They only require electrons and protons. You never hear about quarks in the connection with, superconductors. I mean, you don't need quarks for anything. And then you go into chemistry, and chemists, there's something called quantum chemistry. There's a field, actually very robust, very good, strong field called quantum chemistry. But chemists don't talk about quarks or even protons so much. They lump the nucleus into one thing, and then you have electrons. Basically, chemistry is exchange of electrons. And then you have biochemistry, where quantum effects are not even talked about, with some exceptions, but by and large. Then, of course, we'll come to it. So the difficulty is not so much with the structural hierarchy, because that's one thing, but with the interactions within the manifolds of these objects. So the objects and interactions. That's what a field is, a field of intellectual endeavor. And by the way, I want to bring in one concept that you might be interested in learning about, if you haven't yet, and impress your colleagues in whatever courses you take after this one. It's called the immense number. It's actually a precise number. It's 10 to the power of 110. Why is it important to know this number? Because this number is an absolute barrier to our knowledge. Just like Heisenberg principle is an absolute barrier to our precise knowledge, the immense number is an absolute barrier to our ability to inspect a set of that many objects. Because if you took the entire universe, the mass of the universe, and each hydrogen atom was represented by a bit of information in the universe, the mass of the universe in hydrogen atoms, and the time of the universe in picoseconds, which would be the fastest transitions that you can think of at the level of quantum transitions. You multiply the time of the universe in these units of picoseconds times the mass of the universe in hydrogen atoms. In other words, the entire universe being a computer for as long as it's been around, namely 15 billion years, the product is 10 to the power 110. So if you have a set that is that big, the universe as a computer could never even inspect this entire set in its existence. So what? Well, actually, there's a lot of sets that we deal with on a daily basis that are bigger than that. For example, the human genome is way bigger than the immense set, because it's four base pairs, so it's 4 to the power, how long is the, some 10 billion base pairs, right? But even if you remove the junk DNA, which we don't know if it does anything or not, you'll have 30,000 genes or so, and each gene will have 1,000 or so base pairs. So we are talking about at least 4 to the power of 100 million. So the number of possibilities in terms of creating new genetics is beyond immense. Is I don't know the word. It's beyond staggering. It's impossible. That's why we'll never run out of new creatures. Okay, so that's an important number to remember, because if before you start doing some number crunching or some coding, you ask yourself the question, will I be able to go through the entire list? And in many cases, you won't be. So this is how you going back to the hierarchy of matter. Roughly speaking, this is how I see it. You know, organisms is accepted, even as this is a single cell bacterium or something, has 10 to the 20th atoms or more. So this is where we have never really done any calculations at this with this many objects, at least even classical, but forget quantum, right? So we don't know if it's quantum or not. We simply cannot calculate it currently. A cell, 10 to the 10th, systems such as organelles, mitochondria or ribosomes, will have a fewer, and this is where some aspects of the biological behavior of these systems are definitely feasible as quantum transitions or processes. We're starting to see the mesoscale, I call it, we're starting to see the emergence of quantum biology lurking around the corner. And then definitely from molecules, or atoms and molecules, and maybe biomolecules, we can tackle this with quantum mechanics. What is special about living systems versus non-living systems? Animate versus inanimate matter. The main thing that differs, and sometimes the same systems are living one moment and dead the next. So, and structurally identical, right? So the difference is actually in energy, the energy level, energy production, energy consumption. Living systems produce and consume energy. Dead systems don't. So you have to look at the basic level of what is biochemical energy. Where is it coming from? And how does it compare to physical energy levels? Can this be quantum? And the answer is yes, definitely. I've listed here the most important types of bonds involved in biochemical structure formation. And the most important thing is at the bottom, which is energy production. I call it the biochemical quantum of energy, is the ATP, is the currency that all the living systems use for energy production or transduction. ATP or GTP. In Canada, a scientist from Laurentian coined this term, biological energy quantum, which is roughly 10 to the minus 20th joules. This is the order of magnitude of ATP, GTP energy. And that's perverse throughout biology. So we can already think about energetically biological systems using quanta. They don't use 1.5 of ATP. They use 1 ATP, 2 ATP, 3 ATP, or GTP. Okay. And the second number on this list, which is significant, is KT. We talked about thermal noise, room temperature or physiological temperature being important, and people think destroying quantum coherence. I would say that this is a threshold below which you can safely ignore any type of energy, because thermal vibrations will wash it out. So that's, on the one hand, you have the noise level, 0.6 kilocalories per mole, that's KT, at physiological temperature. And then on the other hand, you have the ATP energy, which is higher, actually. It's about 5 times KT. So that's important. Let's think about it. The biological quantum of energy is 5 times greater than free energy of thermal noise. So it cannot be accidental because it's too high. At the same time, it's small. It's small that is comparable to quantum effects in physics in this sense of smallness. Okay. What I told you so far is trivial, actually. People call it as a trivial application of quantum mechanics to biology. Nothing really profound there, just some numbers. What most of the deep thinkers in the field are after is demonstration of exotic phenomena due to quantum mechanics happening in biology. And the exotic phenomena involve superposition, number one. That is, a system can be in 2 states at the same time. You can go through this door and that door at the same time. Can we find this in biology somewhere, where a system, and maybe it's too big, you know. I wouldn't give up on this, but it's very difficult. The second is non-locality. Non-locality is probably the most bizarre aspect of quantum mechanics. At the level of elementary particles, you can demonstrate that two particles will be connected or interacting over astronomical distances. So we can affect one particle that is so far away that there is no possible physical interaction because it's simply how quantum mechanics is constructed. And that has been demonstrated experimentally. Now, where I think one might seek such manifestations is in very bizarre phenomena. We're afraid to say that, actually. We're afraid to venture into the unknown and controversial. But telepathy, where you know, you can't really explain, and I don't know if you've experienced, but you must have read about the experiences of other people who are, let's say, aware of somebody's passing half the world away, or something that happened the next day. You know, so this is all this bizarre stuff that quantum mechanics actually has as part and parcel of it. So I don't know how to write a Schrödinger equation for telepathy, but you know, maybe one day we will be able to do it. Okay, so entanglement, that's part of non-locality. Tunneling is another strange phenomenon, and actually it's not as bizarre as the other ones. Simplest put, tunneling means the ability for a particle to go over obstacles. It's like ghosts, obstacles, barriers, in the case when the particle has not enough energy to jump over it. It'll still tunnel. There's a probability it'll go over it nonetheless. That's basically what it is. So, but tunneling phenomena are very abundant in things like enzymatic reactions in chemistry and quantum chemistry, where you go over a potential barrier, and sometimes you don't have enough energy to do it, but you'll do it anyway. So that's really quantum. That's quantum at heart. Okay. So this is where most of the incredible breakthrough activity will happen, I think, when we actually get to the bottom of these, how these phenomena can be found and demonstrated in biological systems. I attended a conference this year in Sicily on quantum psychiatry. I was invited as a physicist. And this is not a joke. I mean, psychiatrists and psychologists are thinking that quantum physics is the only way of explaining some of psychic phenomena, not in a necessarily bizarre sense, but even psychiatric disorders and so on. There is an effort to do that. Okay. So this is a list of objections by people who are perennial skeptics to quantum mechanics and biology, because because life is big, life systems are too big, too hot, too wet, too slow, too complex, too fuzzy, and too real and local and stable. But this is, in the end, just a grab bag of objections, and each one at a time can be tackled, and at least exceptions can be raised to this. And as I told you, the size necessarily is a problem because there are macroscopic phenomena. Temperature is another problem because there are room temperature quantum phenomena. Water, we have problems with water, I have to admit. Water is a very difficult substance to analyze physically and complicates a lot of things. I will leave it aside, but it's not an impossible criticism to overcome. Slowness of life, well, I would rephrase it. I would say the following. When you look at life processes, it's not so much it's slow, it's that it spans many, many orders of magnitude. Because, and I'll tell you how many. At the level of atomic motions of biomolecules, this is picoseconds, 10 to the minus 12 seconds. Large conformational motions of DNA and proteins, nanoseconds, 10 to the minus 9. Translocation inside the cell, movement, microseconds to milliseconds, 10 to the minus 6, 10 to the minus 3. Then you have cellular processes, locomotion and so on, seconds, division, minutes to hours, cell division, lifespan, years, right? So you go from minus 12 to, I don't remember, plus 6 or something like this, maybe more seconds, something like 20 orders of magnitude if you want to integrate all of this on the time axis. So there is really nothing in physics comparable in terms of the dimensional scale. But I think these objections and challenges actually raise the bar and make it more interesting, because quantum mechanics has the ability to reconcile some of these difficulties, such as collective degrees of motion. So biochemistry completely ignores collective behavior, synchronization. You know, cell biology is all about organization, functional, structural organization, synchronization, and biochemistry just looks at binary interactions. Maybe sometimes you have three molecules coming together. So physics is the right way. Whether it's quantum, we have to wait and see. Self-organization, nonlinear interactions. So robustness of cells, that's nonlinear. Now, I still have a few minutes, and we're getting to the meat of it, so I don't want to miss it. Actually, the history of talking about biology in terms of quantum mechanics is very long. It's almost as long as physics, as quantum physics. And all the founders of quantum mechanics thought about biology. With Bohr and Heisenberg, Schrödinger, by the way, he wrote a fundamental book that transformed generations of biologists who read that book. The book is entitled, What is Life? It's a fantastic read. You can read it in one evening. And it was written in 1945 or 6. Schrödinger was at that time in Ireland. He escaped. He wasn't Jewish, but his wife was, and he escaped Austria after the Anschluss. And so he studied biology, I guess, what else to do during the Second World War. So he wrote that book, which is fantastic. And he raised a lot of deep issues about, you know, what is really bizarre about biology from the physical point of view. And then others are listed here. And then, so there's a almost different strands of thinking within the physics community, biophysics community, trying to understand biology using deep or not so deep physics, quantum most of the time. That involves things like biophotons. Biological systems, when they are alive, actually they emit photons that do not actually follow the black body radiation. You know, we started with black body radiation because these are not spontaneous emissions, but this is at the level of non-equilibrium thermodynamics. So a lot of people spend a lot of time trying to analyze biophotons. Image this, how biophoton distributions relate to disease states, for example. There's a lot of papers on that. Then, starting with Davidov in the 70s and 80s, there was a school of physicists who tried to explain energy transfer within biological systems because it's very efficient. It's amazingly efficient how energy gets distributed in a messy environment. So it has to rely on some very intricate mechanisms. So these people came up with the concept of soliton energy transfer. Solitons are waves which are compact, and they travel without loss. Unfortunately, we have not found very solid confirmation for this. And then long-range coherence. So that's still, I think, an open issue. All of us have a sense of unity, right? As a human being, you think about yourself as one person, not 10 trillion cells. And how is the sense of unity, and not only sense, but functional unity, achieved? So again, there is some literature on achieving coherence through nonlinear interactions at the level of, even below the cell, and going both below and above the cell level. So this is a long list of various aspects of biology that people try to explain using quantum physics. Now, don't be overwhelmed. And remember what I said in the beginning. Do you remember the landscape in pre-quantum physics? There was a whole lot of experiments that were sort of out of whack. They couldn't grapple with how to explain this. And again, in, for example, just give you one or two examples where we really have no clue how to solve this problem. One is the protein folding problem. You know, there is the Leventhal's paradox that if a protein had to explore its conformational space, it would take more than the age of the universe for it to fold. Yet, you put a peptide chain in a solution, it'll fold in a matter of milliseconds. Okay, how does it explore the available conformations? And one explanation is actually it's a quantum computing, quantum search algorithm. There are serious papers explaining the folding problem using quantum search algorithms. Okay, another is evolution itself. How does evolution, you know, rapidly find solutions under environmental stress and so on? And again, there are some papers by Jojo McFadden, for example, using quantum physics to explain genetic evolution. And so the list is long. I have no time to go through every item. The presentation will be posted, so anybody who is interested might take a look at this. And there are some recent publications on this. What I want to say that now this field is gaining respectability because one particular phenomenon was dissected very precisely, experimentally and theoretically, namely photosynthesis. In the last 3 years, there were a flurry of papers in Science and Nature, very high-profile journals, demonstrating that photosynthesis is a quantum phenomenon. There's no two ways about it. The capture of light, the excitation of electrons, the transfer of energy over reasonably long periods of time at the level of cells, so this is hundreds, maybe thousands of picoseconds, require the quantum coherence. And so you can look this up again. There's quite a few papers on this. That's frolic, so I'll skip it. That's pre-photosynthesis. Frolic was actually a sad story. He's one of those people that should have gotten the Nobel Prize but never did, although he lived to be 91 and still waited and waited and never got the Nobel Prize. For some reason, He was one of the discoverers of the theory of superconductivity. And then towards the end of his life, in the last two decades of his life, he focused on biological coherence. And he wrote a lot of papers arguing that biological systems, in order to transfer energy and create functional organization, required not only non-equilibrium, but non-linear and quantum processes. So I'll skip this. So that's photosynthesis. How much time do I have, by the way?
Fine.
Okay. So photosynthesis, and I want to just give you the gist of it. And why is photosynthesis important? Because this is the way plants harness energy. And without energy, as I told you, there's no life. So at least in the plant kingdom, this effect is critical. And if this effect, photosynthesis, is quantum, then quantum physics plays a crucial role, at least in the plant kingdom. We don't have similar demonstrations importance of quantum mechanics in the animal kingdom, but I have indication that a very similar process is going on. I'm actually trying to get some people interested in moving on from photosynthesis to mitochondrial energy generation, oxidative phosphorylation. So there was work done on the FMO complex in green sulfur bacteria, which are photosynthetic. They have chlorophyll, and this is the complex. Looks messy. In the cytoplasmic membrane, you have this electron transfer complex. If you look more carefully, and people have done this, you see something like this. Now, suddenly, from messy stuff, you see something very symmetrical, very well organized. These aromatic rings, seven of them, within the FMO complex, form an exciton. Exciton is a quantum of electron excitation in terms of a dipole switch. This is at the root of the quantum phenomenon in photosynthesis. In these complexes, electrons can absorb photons, light, and go to the next level, and they actually share this excitation amongst the seven complexes. So people calculated these interaction energies and solved the problem, solved the Schrödinger equation for the first biological system. These are the parameters. Never mind, you'll be able to look at that at home if you're interested. So in quantum mechanics, I forgot to tell you, in the Schrödinger equation, there is an important operator. The most fundamental property in physics is energy, right? Conservation of energy. We all know about this. In classical physics, energy, in quantum physics, the equivalent of energy is called the Hamiltonian. It's an operator. And every system has its own Hamiltonian. So this is the first example of a biological system's Hamiltonian. It was constructed and solved in the Schrödinger equation formalism. And then you can see, by solving it, you can create this wave function that propagates through the system. Remember, we started with the wave function, the first postulate of quantum mechanics. Now we are using it in photosynthetic bacteria to represent the action of absorption and transduction of electromagnetic energy in the bacteria. So I think this is a fundamental step. Maybe at the same level, remember these major experiments, Einstein's photoelectric effect? Isn't it similar? We're looking at electromagnetic radiation being captured by a biological system and energy in the form of exciton traveling through it. In physics, the cell, the photocell, captured electromagnetic radiation and it ejected electrons, and then the currents were measured. Very similar conceptually. So these are how the experiments are done with these isolated systems, and there are three laser light beams, and then one signal field emitted and analyzed. And they also observe even quantum beating, because as you know, two frequencies close to each other will form beats, just like acoustic beats. Now, tryptophan is an amino acid which plays a crucial role in fluorescence. As you may know, tryptophan is used in fluorescence quenching. If a molecule has, biomolecule has tryptophan, then you can do fluorescent experiments. And has a long history of analysis in the context of quantum processes in proteins, and is also present in these bacteria. But I'm going to switch gears now, and I promised that I would talk about metabolism, because I think that plants are just a stepping stone to animals, and there you go. What's the difference? This is a eukaryotic cell in mitosis. Well, on the left you have interphase, on the right you have mitosis. And there are two things which are worth paying special attention in the context of a eukaryotic cell. At least two. Everybody talks about the DNA, I don't ignore it. But in this particular case, I want to draw your attention to two things. First of all, microtubules, because microtubules are the most rigid, the most organized, the most symmetrical organelles in any cell. And the second thing, which is not shown here, but next to microtubules, you will find mitochondria. They're not shown here, but in interphase, mitochondria co-localizes microtubules. So where you see these cylinders, next to them you'll see mitochondria. Okay, why is that? Why am I interested in these two? Well, microtubules for sure, because we would like to understand cell division. And without microtubules, there is no cell division. Now, after 25 years of investigations, in 1997, the crystal structure of tubulin was obtained. Tubulin is the protein that makes up microtubules. Tubulin is a building block of microtubules. So what? Well, we now have detailed information about what tubulin looks like at the level of every atom. Atomistic resolution is available. Well, that's interesting for many reasons, but today I'll only talk about quantum reasons. So a dimer, alpha, beta dimer, and then you make a protofilament, and protofilaments make sheets, and sheets make cylinders. And cylinders are microtubules. And when microtubules grow and capture chromosomes, this is the beginning of cell division. And then when they start shrinking, connected to chromosomes, then you separate them, go to anaphase, and create two daughter cells. Synchronization is amazing. I don't know if you've seen cell division images, videos of cell dividing cells with microtubules stained. It's quite amazing how they organize themselves so precisely and so synchronously. Okay. Remember the FMO complex? The seven things and... Well, what I've shown here is a lattice of seven tubulin dimers. So a microtubule is a cylinder. I'm showing you one cluster of the building blocks, tubulins, and the red lines connect tryptophans. Tryptophans are fluorescently excitable, and when you do the measurements as we did, the distances between these tryptophans are within 2 nanometers, between 1 and 2 nanometers, which is actually the limit for quantum tunneling. It's called the first order distance in quantum chemistry. In other words, what I'm saying is that microtubules are very likely operating, some of the degrees of freedom in microtubules operating in the quantum regime, and they are able to do what photosynthetic systems are doing, namely transfer quantum excitations along the lattice. Why would this be even important? Because if that's the case, then maybe synchronization, for example, in mitosis, as one example, or maybe in our brain, because microtubules also are present, in fact, fill neurons densely. They're present in the brain, and they perform a number of functions in neuronal cells. So there could be a lot of interesting things going on that we haven't even thought about. So this is unpublished work. We are just submitting it with my former student, Travis Craddock. We did exactly the same calculations as were done for photosynthetic bacteria with the tryptophans in tubulin, and we obtained simulations solving the Schrödinger equation for this complex, indicating long-lived coherence. In other words, if you can excite these tryptophans, then there will be quantum coherence within microtubules. Needs to be verified, but the idea, I think, is sound. I will finish now with one more sort of overarching concept. I'll try to put it together in something to think about. If you can give me 5-7 minutes. So, to me, biology is all about energy, directing energy flow. Right? If you can't do it, you're not alive. What is at the core of energy generation in biological systems? Well, you have two things: photosynthesis in plants, and mitochondria and oxidative phosphorylation in animals. There is a glycolysis, and it's fermentation. There's another way of creating energy. But this is, I don't want to get into it because it's actually very explosive. You then bring all kinds of stuff like cancer and so on. But by and large, you have mitochondria and photosynthetic complexes. In mitochondria, the process of energy generation is very, very complex. You have cycles of reactions. You have the Krebs cycle, and then you have the citric acid cycle, and you have oxidative phosphorylation in the mitochondrial membrane. There's again 5 complexes, and in these complexes, electrons are hopping, hop, from one residue to the next in these membrane proteins, and the distances again are within 2 or so nanometers or less. That has not been demonstrated to be quantum, but I know people who are working on it. But even without this knowledge, I want to show you how you can deduce that it is quantum. Okay. I need to wait. Do you want to exercise a little bit? Because this is not something that I can say in like off the cuff in 5 minutes. And okay. So we are changing the topic a little bit, but stay with me. We have to go back to 1931. There was a Frenchman called Kleiber, and he was obsessed with measuring metabolic rates of all organisms in plants, animals, you know, the humans, different sizes, and he ended up codifying all of this under the name of allometric scaling laws. Basal metabolic rate scaling with the mass of the animal, including humans. So, you know, it's very important to know, right? Because you want to know what is your caloric requirement depending on your age and mass and all this. So there's, surprisingly, there are very few exponents in this scaling law. And you see these two, one for plants, 3/4 for animals. Almost all animals transduce their energy or have a metabolic rate which scales to the 3/4 power with their mass. In other words, if you if you increase the mass 16 times, the caloric requirement is only 8 times greater. That's okay. So that's how it goes. What does it have to do with anything? Well, it's been almost a century, and nobody has really convincingly explained where it's coming from, this very interesting scaling law. I think we did. With a colleague of mine, Lloyd Demetrius at Harvard, we introduced a quantization principle. Consider these complexes as oscillators because they constantly oscillate, and they have a characteristic frequency of transduction of these enzymes. And if you introduce mathematically the energy frequency relationship like Planck did, remember E equals HF, Planck constant, this is omega is the frequency. And then I have to take another step back because it's really critical. In 1930-something, Einstein tried to explain another experiment, which was in the beginning of quantum theory, which was the specific heat of solids. How much heat solids require to increase the temperature by 1 degree. This was the first time ever that Einstein made a mistake. He assumed that the solid is a collection of atoms that oscillate all at the same frequency. Paul Debye got the Nobel Prize for explaining it correctly. And his explanation involved wave propagation through the solid. Not individual oscillators, coupled oscillators, and waves, like a sea. And the important thing is that this was tested experimentally, and Debye won. He predicted scaling of the specific heat with the third power of temperature. Okay, that's not critical to this argument, but I just want to give you as a historical remark. Why is this relevant to metabolism? Because if you think about all our cells in the body using energy, each of the cells requires a lot of metabolic enzymes and involves mitochondria, the different geometries, etc. If you use Debye's calculation for the energy, this is the formula, and calculate the energy rate and do the scaling with the number of oscillators, i.e. mass, you end up with this. An empirical formula, and I'll just explain to you, and this will be it. Don't go away. Because you'll miss the most important thing. The metabolic rate scales with weight, W, and the exponent D over D plus 1. D is dimensionality. If D is 1, is 1/2. If D is 2, is 2/3. If D is 3, three-dimensional, 3/4. That's our exponent. So we believe that you can explain metabolic rates across the species with the assumption that you have coupled oscillators transducing energy at the molecular level, and that is a quantum biology manifestation. You can go. Sorry. I didn't want to embarrass you. Okay. So this will be in your notes. I have no time to go through all this, but we did the calculation, how many mitochondria in the human body, how many cells, how many ATP ases, how frequently, what's the frequency of oscillation, how much energy, and when you do all of this calculation, you end up with the equivalent of the Planck constant for a biological system. Remember, in the beginning, energy equals H times F. We have the same thing, except there's a different H, biological Planck constant. And this H is 10 to the 11th times greater than the Planck constant. And surprise, surprise, it's the same ratio as the number of atoms in the mitochondrion. So the whole mitochondrion is like one physical particle. I'll stop at this point because I really extended my welcome mat here too much. Thank you.